What if I were to tell you there's a real-life love potion? Whether it came in a little perfume spritzer or a nasal spray, if there were a chemical with a natural love response, or the ability to make someone feel close to you, people would want that. So when scientists discovered a chemical that bonds mothers with children, makes mammals monogamous, and sees a natural height during the peak of sex, people got very, very curious. But it wasn't some sixth-year Hogwarts student that found it. It was an endocrinologist. This love potion is actually a hormone called oxytocin. And as I'm sure you were guessing, its story is so much more complex than just a magic love potion. Back in the early days of hormone research, scientists discovered that the pituitary gland in your brain did a lot more than they first thought. Towards the tail end of the 1800s, experiments were starting to show that if you inject pituitary extract into animals, you can raise their blood pressure. And eventually, some of those experiments started zeroing in on a chemical in the posterior part of the gland. That helped give rise to the idea that the two lobes of the pituitary could do different things. So researchers' next thought was, sweet, let's see what these babies can do. Remember Starling and Bayliss, the dudes who properly discovered the first hormones? Well, one of their students found progress in the weirdest of places, a fungal disease that grows on rye plants called ergot. It's gonna seem like the story goes on a non-hormone tangent, so bear with me. See, when people ate ergot-infected rye, they developed this potentially fatal illness that had muscle spasms and hallucinations and fever. It was bad. But when used a different way, ergot was kind of a folk medicine remedy that was said to speed childbirth. So that student, Henry Dale, he worked with a chemist to extract different compounds from ergot and found that some of the chemicals had a chilling effect on the sympathetic nervous system, the same nerves that get your muscles and your heart rate all excited. Dale would get credited with discovering an important brain chemical called acetylcholine and for laying the groundwork for research on neurotransmitters. So then why does this guy get so much credit in hormone research? While Dale was messing around putting the active ingredient in ergot into a bunch of different animals, he also would sprinkle in a bit of adrenaline hormone. He writes his results and puts them out in a paper in 1906. And that research paper was wild. I'll link it in the description below, but he basically takes these cats and measures their response of different body parts to these chemicals, like even including the muscles around the eyes. A lot of his results showed what we already expected, that this chemical causes certain muscles to contract. And to Dale, that was the main takeaway from his research. But in his experiment, he kind of randomly gave a shot of ox posterior pituitary to a pregnant cat. Interestingly enough, that caused the cat's uterus to start contracting. And that was cool and everything, but Dale was really more interested in the fact that his mystery chemical caused muscle contractions. In the next few years, scientists would watch as this chemical would prompt things like breast milk production or inhibit urination in men and act as an antidiuretic. But otherwise, oxytocin research stayed pretty low-key until the 1940s and 50s. And who knows when research would have picked up again if it weren't for the kind of accidental research of Vincent Duvigneau. This dude was actually a biochemist who was more interested in the structure of insulin than anything else. Since he was already poking around in the posterior pituitary, Duvigneau eventually isolated the hormone and named it oxytocin after the Greek for swift birth. So by the 1950s, this hormone was starting to get a little bit of love. Scientists quickly came up with a synthetic or lab-made version of oxytocin that had the exact same effect as the natural version. Now, around the same time outside of the lab, scientists were studying the bond between mothers and their kids. Baby goats, those kind of kids. This student at Yale, Peter Klopfer, was studying goats and found that if you separate the mother and baby immediately after birth, then returned it to the mother 5 minutes later, she rejected her own baby like it was a stranger. He eventually got pretty tired of sleeping in the barn for his research, so he actually rented a house from a professor and converted the living room into a little mini goat farm. It's like every scene from a teen rom-com ever, right? Parents are out of town, so let's have a party with red Solo cups and goat hormones. But that's weird, right? Like, why would the mother shun the baby she just gave birth to? So maybe a chemical that hit right at childbirth was responsible. So they thought, well, what about oxytocin? To be fair, there was a lot more science than that, and other scientists thought that the hormone prolactin might be involved too. It would take a few years for the oxytocin hypothesis to be validated, but we'll come back to that. Now, one thing that happens during childbirth, for obvious reasons, is a huge increase in elasticity of the cervix and vagina. Stretching of all that then triggers a release of oxytocin. It's pretty easy to get that stretch when you're pushing a baby out, but how could we simulate that with science? Klopfer and his colleague came up with this balloon device that they would insert into goat cervixes, inflate the balloon, and try to trigger that stretch reflex. And it worked. After they did their thing with the balloons, these goats would exhibit more maternal behaviors even around just random baby goats. Now, the researchers were still mimicking something that only happens during childbirth, So more research needed to be done to show that oxytocin was responsible, as opposed to some kind of response from the mechanical stimulus. A few years later, Klopfer's assistant Peterson, now a grown scientist out in the world doing his own science, injects some estrogen and oxytocin into rats' brains. Boom! Maternal pair bonding happens again. Peterson, along with research that came out of Cambridge in the early 80s, showed that those sex hormones like estrogen and progesterone could buff up maternal pair bonds on their own, but not nearly as much as oxytocin. But the behavior was more powerful if estrogen and oxytocin were used together. So it seemed like we were finally getting the handle on oxytocin's mother-child function. Here's the thing. If this hormone could strengthen the bond between mother and child, could it also strengthen other social bonds, like maybe romantic bonds? That's a logical follow-up question, but how are you going to experiment on that in humans? What animal is closely related enough to humans and can create strong social bonds as an adult? Like, where are you gonna find a monogamous mammal? They found this guy, the prairie vole. And look at how cute this thing is. It's just so, oh my gosh, it's so cute. Experiments showed that when you shot some oxytocin into one of these little fluff nuggets around their partners, they stayed monogamous for life. But if they didn't get that oxy surge, they tended to have lots of sexual partners. A few years later, oxytocin's pituitary cousin vasopressin was also shown to help out in selective partner preference behavior. That's how scientists say vole marriage. Now, clearly some people hear that and they think, so you're saying that all I need is a big needle of hormones and I can finally get Ryan Reynolds to fall in love with me? First off, no way. Everyone knows that Ryan Reynolds is deathly afraid of needles. Second, a study of little rodents that have the capacity to form monogamous relationships is still a far cry from human studies. Yeah. About those human studies. Back in 1987, an experiment at Stanford cut right to the chase and decided to measure blood oxytocin levels at different stages of arousal. There's a link to the study down in the description, and I'll spare you the details, but let's just say that oxytocin levels got to their height at the peak of the roller coaster. The correlation between the chemical and the timing was pretty obvious, but it wasn't really clear yet what caused it. Did oxytocin cause excitement, or did excitement cause oxytocin, or was it both, or was it neither? The Stanford team thought that the oxytocin release was related to the smooth muscle contraction in the reproductive system during the roller coaster, basically looping back to Dale's cat experiment in the early 1900s. Either way, human social relationships are weird and complicated and are way more involved than just hormones. Unfortunately, the media is not so great at imagining and describing the intricate complexities of society and the body. So in 2005, an article published in the kind of super reputable journal Nature made some waves in the headlines. And the study design is worth getting into, so buckle up. The article is titled, "Oxytocin Increases Trust in Humans." And it starts off with straight up poetry. Like, here's the opener. Trust pervades human societies, which they include not one, but two references for. The actual experiment got a bunch of male university students together to play this game where you were assigned to be either an investor or a trustee. As an investor, you could send your fictional money to the trustees, which could then send you back a certain amount of money. The fictional money each player had at the end of the experiment did get converted and paid out as real money at the end, but there were some real-life consequences here. Now, before the game, researchers gave each participant a nasal spray which had either oxytocin or a placebo in it. Now, I've already told you the headline, so clearly the researchers concluded that the participants who got the oxytocin spray played the game in such a way that showed that they trusted their partners. But here's the actual results graph from their study. I know that's a big bar on the right, but looking at those results, do you think we can really conclude that an oxytocin spray actually increases trust? Well, the news did, and before you knew it, products marketed with names like Liquid Trust were coming out. Either way, the findings from that 2005 Nature article weren't extremely powerful, and most of the oxytocin studies that have come out since then have really small sample sizes, so we don't have a ton of conclusive facts yet. But what we're learning is that this little hormone is way more involved in other parts of the brain than we used to think. Like, oxytocin is a huge deal in activating the amygdala, the part of your brain that processes fear. So researchers are currently testing oxytocin's role in autism and social anxiety disorders. Their thought is that nasal spray might help reduce activation of the amygdala and help people cope with fear. But it's still super early on and nothing has been FDA approved. Ultimately, we're at a really exciting time in our understanding of oxytocin, and I'm excited to see where things go from here. Thanks for watching episode 4 in the Hormone series. Next week, we'll continue the theme of male doctors making wildly wrong assumptions about women's bodies with the story of estrogen. If you want to keep up with the rest of the Hormone series, make sure to press the subscribe button, like the video, and say what's up in the comments. It's always so nice talking to you all there. It's such a great place these days. Have fun, be good, and I'll see you next time.